A man drank 3 scoops of horse electrolytes at nighttime. This is what happened to his brain. HW is a 44-year-old man presenting to the emergency room, agitated, confused, and with a massive headache. Paramedics tell the admitting nurse that they saw him have a seizure. When he regained consciousness, he had no idea where he was. The previous night, HW was with Mike. They had gotten to know each other 1 week earlier because HW had a girlfriend named Katie. He had been dating her for a couple of years. Mike also had a girlfriend he'd been dating for a couple years, also named Katie. And this week, both men found out they had the same girlfriend. Depressed, the men went into no contact with Katie, and HW and Mike got to know each other. HW had been having health problems. He was tired all the time. He had horrible insomnia, but the doctor would tell him to get cognitive behavioral therapy that never worked for him. His body ached and his head would hurt, and no amount of ibuprofen would fix anything. More recently, he had stomach pains that would cause him nausea and vomiting. He'd have weird spots on his skin. He couldn't get a good answer from the doctor about anything, but where he thought he got an answer was the farming supply store. One day, while browsing, he saw horse electrolytes. Horses are strong. They need to be well hydrated. If you wanted to be as strong as horses and electrolytes hydrate the horses, then the answer is right in front of him. He also saw someone tweet positively about it recently, so no better time than now to drink the horse electrolytes. Half a scoop and he'd feel great. Definitely no such thing as a placebo. With Mike, HW talked about rehydration. He said that hangover is caused by massive urination of water. So if alcohol leads to water loss, but electrolytes replenish water, well then horse electrolytes will basically turn you into the fountain of youth. The more you drink, the stronger you'll be. And it was time for them to drink. HW became so inebriated that he couldn't even remember his own name. He dumped an unknown number of horse salt scoops into a cup and drank as one of the last things that he could remember. But the natural reaction kicked in. It was so much salt that it burned on the way down. His stomach felt like it was on fire. Hours later, on the couch, he suddenly got up in a world of hurt. He went to use the bathroom, and it was here where he has his first seizure. Mike got up at the commotion to see what was happening. Panicked, he calls for 911, and HW is brought to the emergency room, where we are now. Drinking a massive amount of supplement designed for a horse is gonna cause problems if you're not a horse. One difference between animal and human supplements are the reported amounts. Typically, on human supplements, you'll see exact amounts per serving size. We tend to be familiar with and take more care of the needs of our own. But animal supplements, on the other hand, aren't quite as exact. They cite ranges or guarantee minimums. There's a lot of variability in humans, no doubt, but with how much larger a horse is than a human, the differences from one horse to another, just from a number standpoint, might be greater, so this should make sense. What also makes sense is what's happening to HW. Let's suppose that he took just 3 scoops, and conservatively, we use the maximum values when a range is cited, and we use the minimum value when there is no range, and we can go right through the list. Copper is a metal. It's used by our bodies to make chemical reactions happen. The highest concentrations are in the brain, liver, and kidneys. Too much copper in the body can stress the cells, but horse electrolytes is made of 0.001% copper. Even in 3 full scoops, this isn't even close to cause HW's problems. Zinc is also a metal, sometimes considered the opposite of copper, in the body. Because when you take copper, your body eliminates zinc. And when you take zinc, your body eliminates copper. Zinc is also used to make different chemical reactions happen. The amount of zinc in horse electrolyte is a little high for humans, but not high enough to cause any of HW's problems. Iron is a metal commonly found in our red blood cells, where it's critical to holding on to oxygen. Too much iron can be corrosive. It can destroy the metabolism and injure cells. But the horse electrolytes that HW took didn't contain enough iron to do any of this in 3 scoops. And potassium. There's a lot of potassium in our body, mostly inside cells. It sends signals for the body to do things. The most immediately life-threatening thing that high potassium can do is stop the heart. But the kidneys are very efficient in getting rid of potassium, and HW doesn't have anything wrong with his kidneys, so there's not enough here to cause him problems. Calcium is a mineral that's used by the body to make bones, and also to send signals inside cells. Too much calcium can cause electrical discharge in the brain, and it can shut down the kidneys. HW would have gotten a maximum dose of almost 8 grams. This can cause symptoms, most notably one that he already has, coma. But the kidneys have a way to filter this out fairly efficiently, so it might not be that big of a problem if he really did take just 3 scoops. Manganese is also a metal that's used by the body for chemical reactions. Horses probably need a lot of it to maintain their normal function, and humans aren't horses. Their bodies do more work than ours. They're bigger than us. When we get too much manganese, bad things can start to happen to the brain. This could explain HW's seizure and unconsciousness because the 3 scoops of horse electrolytes that he took is 1,500% more than normal human daily intake. And while this is high, it's not the highest thing that he took. Salt is sodium chloride, and what's listed as sodium is likely a form of sodium bicarbonate because pure sodium metal explodes when you put it in water, so there's no way that they put pure sodium in here. Combining the total sodium content means that 60% of the 3 scoops contain sodium. This functionally comes out to as much sodium as 1/3 cup of salt, and that's more than the lethal dose of sodium. A blood test predictably finds that HW has hypernatremia. Hyper meaning high. Natri referring to sodium, or more formally natrium, as shown by its symbol on the periodic table of elements. And emia meaning presence in blood. High sodium presence in blood. The reason that this is so life-threatening is because wherever sodium is, water will flow towards it. In this small science experiment, I dissolve horse electrolyte in this water and place it into a tube. I submerge the tube in a pool of distilled water, and you'll see that water flows into the tube. That water flows towards the sodium. If HW has high sodium presence in blood, then it means that water is flowing out of his organs and into his blood. This is probably fine for organs like the liver, and maybe there's even no problem for the muscles. But where it's going to be a problem is something delicate like the brain. He had a seizure. He was confused. These are brain problems. Inside his skull, his brain has been shrinking as water is getting sucked out. And in the resulting deformation, blood vessels can get sheared, causing a brain bleed, leading to permanent damage if nothing is done about this. If high sodium is present in his blood and water follows that sodium, then one solution is to give him less salty water. This will stop water from exiting his organs. It'll stop the things that are happening to his brain, and it should help get his kidneys to flush out all the excess horse electrolytes that he drank. But the problem is, doctors don't know how long ago he drank this, and this is important because it changes how they're gonna treat him. Water doesn't only follow salt, it'll follow some other chemicals too. When the brain's size suddenly changes, the brain tries to compensate. It'll try to pump sodium and those other chemicals in to try and maintain water balance. But this compensation happens over time, and those other chemicals that were pumped in aren't normally supposed to be in the brain, and they can't easily get pumped out. Actually, they can cause damage in the brain when it returns to normal. So this means if the medical team reverses HW's hypernatremia too quickly, and his brain has already tried to adapt, then permanent damage will happen. But on the flip side, not treating him now is also going to cause permanent damage if it hasn't already happened. It's a few days later in the hospital. HW's serum sodium was corrected. He sits there with his eyes open, but when doctors try to speak to him, he just stares blankly into the void. It's possible that permanent damage has happened, but was it from the treatment or had it already happened? Hypernatremia's permanent damage would be the brain bleeding from the shrinking and shearing, but rapid correction's permanent damage is something called osmotic demyelination. Myelin being the fatty sheath that covers the brain and the nerves, and osmotic referring to osmosis, the mechanism whereby water flows towards where there's sodium or other chemicals, both of which we would call solute. This means that due to the inappropriate movement of solute and the subsequent water flow, the brain and the nerves are suffering demyelination. And given that myelin helps move electrical signals along the nerve, it means that HW might have trouble controlling his body with his brain. His muscles can't work. He might have problems with his senses, and his brain itself might not work. He might have cognitive problems. It was hard for him to stand. When he could, doctors asked him to close his eyes, and then they saw that he was unstable and needed to hold onto something until he opened his eyes. His speech was incoherent. Typically, when the patellar tendon is tapped, it triggers a reflex in the leg. When the response is diminished, it indicates that something is wrong, and in HW, his response was diminished. And this wasn't the only reflex that had a problem. HW also didn't have a vibratory sense in his lower extremities. Something happened to his brain. If it's demyelination, that should be visible on MRI. Except when the medical team do that MRI, they didn't see demyelination. Really, they didn't see anything wrong. Sometimes demyelination takes a few weeks to be visible on the image, so this doesn't mean absolutely that he doesn't have it. Clearly, HW's brain damage wasn't from the hypernatremia drinking those horse electrolytes. It's unclear if his brain was damaged because doctors fixed his hypernatremia too fast, or if something else was going on. And as the days continue, it starts to become apparent that something else had been happening. HW had prior health problems that he said he never got a good answer for. One of them was a horrible stomach pain. In the hospital, he refused to eat, and doctors discovered why. It was painful for him to eat. Extreme salt ingestion can sometimes irritate the lining of the esophagus and the stomach. This can cause burns, so they sent a scope down his throat to take a look, and instead, they found ulcers. The problem was, they didn't look like they were from salt, so doctors took a sample to find out what they were. This could be peptic ulcer disease, which is typically caused by the bacteria Helicobacter pylori, but when doctors tested for H. pylori, it returned negative. These ulcers were being caused by something else. As the days passed, HW's hypernatremia normalized, but nothing else was improving. He still couldn't feel anything in his legs, his reflexes were impaired, he still couldn't stand while closing his eyes, and he was incoherent. Doctors ordered a lumbar puncture. The brain and the spinal cord are surrounded by cerebrospinal fluid. It acts like a cushion to protect the brain, and it removes waste products from the brain, and it helps with nutrient transport. The puncture collects some of the fluid to sample, and when doctors take a look, they find low sugar, high protein, and white blood cells. None of these are normal, but they didn't find anything else. However, this did give the medical team an idea of what was happening. Back at the stomach ulcer biopsy, doctors had put a stain so that they could have a better idea of what was in there. When they magnified the image, they found a spiral-shaped bacteria present among white blood cells, and suddenly, everything made sense. Syphilis is caused by a spiral-shaped bacteria named Treponema pallidum. It's an STD. Contact with an infected person's sore, called a chancre, will often transfer the bacteria. Microabrasions will develop at the points of contact, you know how that happens, allowing the treponema to get in, especially if it's a mucosal surface, like the mouth. The initial infection is the chancre. It's typically visible in men because of anatomy, but sometimes it's not easily visible, like bottom of the shaft. Most of the time, it doesn't cause any pain. The immune system reacts, and it does a good job. The sore goes away, and everything seems fine. But the treponema bacteria is floating around in the blood and is spreading everywhere. And eventually, it learns to hide from the immune system, staying dormant in the body for anywhere from weeks to years. Only to emerge as a variety of problems like horrible-looking skin rash, hair loss, ulcers all over, inside and outside the body. And it can get into the muscles, it can shut down the kidneys, and worst of all, it can get into the brain, causing the exact problems that HW is having. At this realization, doctors drew HW's blood and did an antibody test for treponema, and it returned positive, meaning that HW has syphilis. And he had it for some time. It's no longer the initial infection, it's the one that's been growing in his stomach, and it's now spread to his brain. It's responsible for some of the spots on his body that were covered by clothes. He didn't have osmotic demyelination syndrome. The medical team corrected his hypernatremia in time. He didn't have permanent damage from the hypernatremia itself. In the days leading up to him drinking the massive amount of horse electrolyte, he had been intermittently having worsening problems. He had been losing weight because his stomach kept hurting. He had been losing hair. His insomnia was becoming severe, and he had urinary incontinence. Syphilis cases have been going up in the United States since 2011, and starting in 2016, they increased rapidly. In the early 2020s, the cases increased so rapidly that there's been a nationwide shortage of the medicine needed to treat it. And even worse, there's new evidence that Treponema pallidum is changing its DNA in ways that we haven't observed before. Some of these changes may one day make the current treatment ineffective because the bacteria has mutated once before to resist the medicine that we used to use. I explain this more on my in-depth channel Heme Review, link in the description below. If HW has a bacterial infection, then antibiotic is his treatment. Luckily, it was in stock, and luckily right now, it's still penicillin. Horse electrolytes became a meme in 2024. There's been a trend of Americans using horse products. I broke it down for you. In an acute setting, the sodium is for sure gonna be the most immediately scary one, followed by manganese and then the calcium in this particular formulation. There might be different ones on the shelf. There's other factors that I don't really quite know about, like how is this product prepared? My guess is, at a minimum, it might be considered gross or unclean to human standards, but anyone working in food preparation knows everything is gross. If someone has gotten to the point where they're actually drinking this, I doubt that they really care if something is clean or not. Different products might have different amounts of electrolytes, but they're all going to say for use in horses only because they're for horses. And it doesn't matter what you think, if you're a human, you're not a horse. One thing that HW was correct about was that having something salty does somewhat help prevent hangovers. And this is because when you drink alcohol, it inhibits antidiuretic hormone. If a diuretic causes you to urinate, an antidiuretic prevents you from urinating. But alcohol inhibits the release of antidiuretic hormone, so a negative negative is a positive, so you get diuretic. The gratuitous water loss gets you that headache. But if sodium causes you to hold onto water because water follows sodium, then that blunts the effect of alcohol as a diuretic. And that's why we have beer nuts and bar pretzels. They do in fact blunt some hangover if you're smart about it and you keep your water intake high. You might still feel some pain because that's a little bit beyond water. That's the acetaldehyde being produced in your body. And we have horse salt, but this is for horses. Hopefully you're not giving your horses alcohol. By the sixth day of treatment, the medical team started noticing that HW's appetite was improving, although he still had intermittent nausea. His attention and thought processes were improving. His neurologic exam was showing that his reflexes were no longer diminished and he had a better vibratory sense. And by day 14, he was starting to improve to the point where he could be discharged soon. Luckily, his hypernatremia that came from actions done during a state of inebriation was corrected in time before his brain was able to compensate. And luckily, he had a diligent medical team that were able to find and treat him for the real problem that he had, because it is one that's sometimes hard to identify, but is increasingly becoming more common now and changing in ways that we haven't seen before. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.